My name is Eliana Pinza Tapia, and as you know, I'm in charge of the English for Academic Purposes subject. Before starting, I would like to congratulate you for investing in your professional growth and for selecting the UTPL to do it. For today, I have organized my presentation in the following way. First, I will present the subject. Then I will talk about a little bit about each one of the topics to be studied during these 2 months. And after that, I will refer to all the activities that you will have to carry out in order to pass the course. And at the end, you will have time in order to ask any question. Okay, so let's start. Okay, English for Academic Purposes is a very important subject included in the Pedagogy for Teaching English as a Foreign Language Master's Program. It is taught in the first semester and is worth 4 credits. This subject will help you express yourself in a written way as clearly and accurately as possible, which is necessary to succeed not only in this program but also in your career. It is important to mention that through the study of this subject, you will focus on important concepts involved in the English academic field, which are necessary in order to produce high quality written material. Once you have learned the theory, you will need to put it into practice. That's the reason why you will have to produce different written material in which you will have to express yourself academically. The contents to be studied have been divided into 2 parts. The first part is focused on the writing process, which are involved in the first nine units. And then the second part is focused on the elements of writing, which involves the study of 7 units. In the first part, you will start with the process of the written stage through proofreading. Then you will learn and practice about using the information you gather through reading without committing plagiarism, and at the end of this part, you will have to focus on the organization of well-written paragraphs. Regarding the second part, you will focus on the key writing elements, such as cohesion, style, and the selection of relevant information, which is necessary in order to support your ideas. All of these elements will help you write in a clear and an effective way. The knowledge acquired in the English for Academic Purposes subject will also help you succeed in all the tasks required to pass each one of the courses involved in this master's program. It is important to mention that the book contains 2 more parts, which are focused on accuracy in writing and writing models, which have not been included in the didactic guide, but you will have to use them as a reference and self-esteem. There are different types of written work produced by students. So among those types, Bailey establishes the following ones: notes, reports, projects, essays, dissertations, theses, and papers. Let's focus on the definition of each one of these types. A note is a written record of the main points of a text. In the case of report, it is a description of something a student has done. A project is a piece of research that can be done in an individual way or maybe in groups. It will depend on the level of difficulty that the selected topic we have, okay? So an essay is a piece of writing several paragraphs long. A thesis, it is the longest piece of writing normally done by a student offered for a higher degree on a topic chosen by a student. And finally, a paper is a general term for any academic essay, report, presentation, or article. During the study of this subject, you will have the opportunity to develop your activities considering this type of texts. Okay? So when we are required to write essays, it is important to consider the format to be used. So Daly, the author of the textbook, presents the following formats for essays. In this case, we have a short essay, which can have the following format. We have an introduction, then we have a main body, paragraph or paragraphs, and a conclusion. For long essays, we have more information. We have an introduction, main body. The main body includes the literature review, a case study, a discussion. Also, we have a conclusion, a section for references, and finally the appendix. For the thesis, the dissertation, we have additional information. Here we have, we start with the abstract, then a list of contents, list of tables, introduction, the main body which includes literature review, case studies, findings, and discussion. Also, we have a conclusion. Here, as you can see, we have a section for the acknowledgement. Then we have the references, and finally we finish with appendices. Okay, it is important to mention that you can use this format as a reference, since there is not a specific format for thesis or for a journal article. So it will depend on us to select the appropriate format, which can be used according to the requirements established to present your work. Yeah, so let's take it just as reference. Writing academically involves the consideration of different features, such as the case of well-written sentences, which need to be a part of paragraphs, of course. So let's focus on the definition of a sentence. It's good to read. I know that you know this definition, but I would like you to remember it, okay? So a sentence is a group of words that you use to communicate your ideas. Every sentence is formed from one or more clauses and expresses a complete thought. So we have two types of sentences, simple sentences and complex sentences. A simple sentence is one independent clause, and a complex sentence contains one independent clause and one or more dependent clauses. Sentences, as I said before, are part of paragraphs. So if we have good sentences, obviously we will have good paragraphs, okay? So that's why I want now to refer to paragraph, which is a group of related sentences that discuss one main idea. It can be as short as one sentence or as long as 10 sentences. So the number of sentences is not important, because the paragraph should be long enough to develop the main idea, but in a clear way. All paragraphs have a topic sentence and supporting sentences, and just some paragraphs also have a concluding sentence. Here we have the parts of the paragraph. So as you know, we have three parts: the topic sentence, supporting sentences, and the concluding sentence. The topic sentence states the main idea of a paragraph. It not only names the topic of a paragraph, but it also limits the topic to one specific area that can be discussed completely in the space of a single paragraph. Develop the topic sentence, which means that they explain or prove the topic sentence by giving extra information about the topic. The last part is concluding sentence, which signals the end of the paragraph and leaves the reader with important points to remember. Okay, so concluding sentences are established for standalone paragraphs. So, however, paragraphs that are part of longer pieces of writing usually do not need concluding sentences, okay? As I previously mentioned, the sentences and paragraphs are features of writing academically, but it's important to consider also other types of features, as we have headings, also the use of brackets, and so on. In order to write, it's important to have different ideas which are going to support what we think. So for that reason, it is important to read a lot of information from different sources. Such is the case of academic texts. We can select them. So they deal with concepts and ideas related to subjects that are studied at college or university. So when you read an academic text, you are expected to do much more than simply understand the words that you will find there, and also summarize main ideas. We can find the information that we need in order to write our tasks by using different sources. For example, we can use information from textbooks, websites, journal articles, official reports, newspapers, or magazine articles, and also in It will depend on us to select the appropriate source, because it will depend on the topic that we will have to write about. To search for the material that you need, the author suggests the use of reading lists, library catalogs, and library websites. And these library websites will help us to search electronic resources. Having these lists will help us to save time when searching for information. So what is important is that the information that you use from an outside source should be reliable. So what it means is that the information should be current, unbiased, and true. So we have to be very careful when selecting the information from internet, especially. Successful writing requires using information that can support our ideas. So that's why it's important to select valuable information, as I said before, by using appropriate reading methods. Bailey mentions that these methods have to be adapted to cope with the volume of reading required. It is important when you are reading in another language. Important to mention that if you don't have time to read every word published on the topic you are studying, so maybe if we have, for example, if we have like 10 paragraphs and we don't have time in order to read all of them, it would be important to read the first sentence of each paragraph, and I'm referring to the topic sentence of each paragraph, in order to have a clear idea about what the paragraph is about. So if we need extra information about that that sentence, maybe we can read the supporting. Another part that is important to consider is to read the titles and subtitles. Let's remember that the title is usually shorter and it's eye-catching. And the subtitle provides more information about the focus. Also, we can check the some features such as the author. Because we check this information, it means that we are going to know if the author is well known in his or her field. Also, it's important to check the publication date and edition. The publication date, because we are going to know if the information that we are going to read is up to date. And also the edition, we will know if the book has been edited. So for example, if there are two editions, it means that it's not going to be important to read the first one, because it has some changes, because there is another edition. So that's why it's we have to be very careful when selecting the sources that we are going to use. Other important feature that we can read is the contents. We can do it to check the list of the main chapters or sections included in the book. This should tell you how much space is given to the topic you are researching. Another feature is the introduction or paraphrase, and as you know, it describes how the text is organized. The reference section gives us suggestions for further reading, so it would be good for us to read this part, because maybe we are going to find additional information from important authors. So let's consider them too. One of the most important parts that I consider the most important is the abstract, because here we are going to have a summary of whole book. So that's why I'm going to refer in this part to abstract. They are normally found in peer-reviewed journal articles, where they act as a kind of summary to enable researchers to decide if it is worth reading the full article. So Creswell mentions also that they are summaries of the major aspects of a study or article, conveyed in a concise way and inclusive of the specific components that describe the study. So it would be very important if we are going to take information from a journal article, maybe, to read first the abstract, because in this case we are going to have a summary of what we are going to read. Yeah, and so we are going to know if it is valuable to read it. Abstracts normally have a standard structure. Here we are going to find a background or a justification of the study, Then also we are going to find the purpose. We are going to find also the information about the method that have been used in order to look for information. And also we are going to find results of the research. We have found the information on the internet we need to consider to be used. It's important to assess the sources in a critical way. Okay, so that's why Bailey says that internet sources are plentiful and conveniently available, but you need to ask yourself the following questions before using them. So the first question is this a reputable website? The second one, is the language in the text in a suitable academic style? Is the name of the author given, and is he or she well known in the field? And the last question, are there any obvious errors in the text which suggest a careless approach? There may be maybe another questions, but these are really important, and they are going to help us a lot when assessing these sources. Okay, so if the answer to these questions is negative, so it's better not to read the text, okay, the information from that source. One of the problems that teachers face is that students use ideas from other authors without citing them. So they present them as theirs, and it is not good because, as you know, it's a serious offense because plagiarism is using someone else's words or ideas as if they were your own, okay? So we have to be very careful when using ideas from other people because we need to give credit to them, okay? So how can we avoid it? Avoid plagiarism? We have to acknowledge the sources. So Bailey mentions that if you borrow from or refer to the work of another person, you must show that you have done this by providing the correct acknowledgement. You can do it, or there are different ways that you can do this. For example, I have here summary and citation, and also quotation and citation. I have two different examples. In the first one, as you can see, it's a summary. Writing the last name of the author, which is Smith, and also we have the date of the year of publication. So this is the information that is needed when we are summarizing. And then also we have another example. In here we have a quotation. How do we know that it is a quotation? Because here we are using quotation marks. And also here, besides providing the last name of the author, also we have in the year of publication, also we have the number of the page where we took the information in a literal way. Yeah. So here you can use these examples in order to. The lack of knowledge regarding the correct use of information written by other people may involve us in uncomfortable situations. So it is necessary to be aware about it in order to avoid being involved in cases of plagiarism. Because plagiarism can be accidental since it's not always easy to define. You can avoid plagiarism also by summarizing and paraphrasing, and also by developing good study habits. According to these authors, when you retell a story that someone has told you, you repeat the story in your own words. If your retelling is about the same length as the original, it is a paraphrase. But if you shorten the story, retelling only the most important points and leaving out the details, it is a summary. So we can use summary or paraphrase as we want, but we have to be careful that we need to cite the author, to the person who has who belongs the information, okay? So also we can avoid plagiarism by developing good habits. So the author suggests the following guidelines, okay? So the first one is plan your work carefully so you do not have to write the essay at the last minute. Also take care to make notes in your own words, not copying from the source. And also, if you're going to use the words of the author, but in a literal way, using quotation marks, but you have to make a difference about the summary, paraphrases, and also quotations. Okay, so keep a record of all the sources you use. Main information that you will use is the author, date, title, page numbers, and publisher. Well, it depends on the source that we will find, because sometimes we are going to use journal articles, and so here we are going to need additional information. So make sure all your in-text citations are included in the list of reference. Now let's move on to the planning process. As you know, when writing, we need to consider a process. So here, Bailey has established the following steps in order to do it in a correct way. So the first step is to analyze the word, the title wording, and decide what is required. Then he states that it's important to brainstorm the topic to focus your ideas. And finally, he says that it is good to prepare an outline using your preferred method. So let's refer to the first one, which was analyzing essay titles. Choosing a clear and an accurate title is crucial because it contains important words known as keywords that tell students what should be done. For example, here we have some examples of keywords. In this case, we have verbs. For example, if we found in a title the word illustrate, it means that we will have to provide examples about something. But if we find the word analyze, it means that we will have to break down into the various parts and the relationship. The second step was brainstorming. As you know, it is a very important aspect, okay? So it is an informal way of generating topics to write about, and it can be done at any time during the writing process. So we can brainstorm in order to write a conclusion or maybe to write an example. So it depends. The important point about brainstorming is that there should be no pressure to be brilliant. So, according to this author, students should simply open their minds to whatever pops into them. The last step is writing outlines. It is important to write them because they not only organize your thoughts, but also keeps you on track once you begin to write. Bailey says that we have to take care at this stage, because in this way we can save and waste the effort later. So the more detail we are going to include in the outline, the easier the writing process will be. When reading, we are going to select the information that we consider is important, but also we need to make notes about the most important information. So when making notes, we will need to choose a method that you feel comfortable with and that suits your purpose, as notes are for you, nobody else. I'm sure that you have your own method to make notes, but here I'm going to present some styles that can be useful too. Here I'm going to present three styles, okay? The first one is standard notes. In this style, the notes are written in a linear format down the page. In the case of pattern notes, they are more visual. So here you are going to start writing the topic in the center, and then we are going to add related ideas around it. Third style is a split page format. This format involves three sections. So here you are going to write your comments on the left, and you are going to have the standard notes on the right, and we are going to write a summary at the end. So maybe you can use the three different styles, so you can still continue using the one that you view that you have been using. Okay, so there are some general guidelines that the author presents in order to make effective notes, okay? So the first one is to avoid the risk of plagiarism, you must use your own words and not copy phrases from the original. So also the quantity of notes you make depends on your task. So maybe you are going to need just a few points, or you are going to need a lot of information. So we have we are going to have a lot of notes. Also, it's important to record the source of your notes. This will save time when you have to write the list of reference. So in this way, you are not going to have to read or to look for the book again in order to find the information that you need. So you are going you will have to do it when you are selecting the information. Okay, so notes are often written quickly, so keep them simple. It's important not to write sentences according to the author, and we should leave out. If we are going to write lists, we will have to have headings and number systems in order to organize the information. So it's important to not to crowd our notes. The use of symbols also it is important, because it's going to help us to save time. Also, it is important to use abbreviation. We can make up our own abbreviations for the subject, but what we have to consider is that we don't have to abbreviate too much, because it's going to maybe in the future we are going to have problems understanding what we have written. Okay, let's move on. Paraphrasing and summarizing. Paraphrasing attempts to rewrite information from an outside source in your own words without changing the meaning. So in order to write an effective paraphrase, it's important to consider the following information. Paraphrase has a different structure to the original. It has mainly different vocabulary, it retains the same meaning, and it keeps some phrases from the original that are in common use. Three different techniques provided by the author, by Bailey. Let's focus on them. The first one is changing vocabulary by using synonyms. Also, we can change word class. It means that we can, if we have a verb, maybe we can change it into a noun, or on the contrary. And then also we can change the word order. This author mentions that it involves retelling only the most important points and leaving out the details. Something that is relevant here is that you have to use your own words. When you are summarizing, it doesn't mean that you are going to take the words from the author in a literal way. No, it means that you are going to use your own words as you did in the paragraph, in the paraphrase too. Okay, so there are some steps that the author provides us in order to write good summaries. The first one is read the original text carefully and check any new or difficult vocabulary. After that, it's important to mark the key points by underlining or highlighting. Once we have done this, we can make notes of the key points. Then we will be ready in order to write the summary from our notes, recognizing the structure if it is necessary. And at the end, it's important to check the summary to ensure it is accurate and nothing important has been changed or lost. There are three ways to insert outside information into your own writing. You can quote the information, or you can summarize it, or maybe you can paraphrase it. I already referred to to paraphrasing and summarizing, so now I'm going to talk about quotations. Quotations from reliable and knowledgeable sources are good supporting details, so that's important to use them, but we don't have to overuse the quotations, okay? So they should be introduced by a phrase that shows the source and also explains how this quotation fits into your argument. So there are different verbs that can be used in order to introduce the quotation, the summary or the paraphrase. Here the author presents a list that I'm going to read. Argue, state, claim, consider, suggest, believe, agree, and define. Maybe we can have more, but I am just mentioning these ones. Here we have an example also about a quotation, and as you can observe here, the verb suggest has been used. When we have to write essays, or any type of a written work, it's important to write at the end a list of references. So it is important to refer correctly to the work of other writers that you have used. So here I have an example of a reference of the book that we are using, Academic Writing, a Handbook for International Students. And you can have it as a reference for citing the information that you have taken from your books. The list of references must be written at the end of your essay or report, as I said before. So be careful when taking notes about the information of this information that we have here. For example, author, date of publication, title of the book, place of publication, and editorial. This information will be needed when we are going to reference to books, but if we have used information from journal articles, different information has to be written, okay? When writing, it is important to check what we have done. So that's why here we have that after completing your first draft, you should leave it for a day and then reread it and asking some questions. So here the author presents these questions. Do the different sections of the paper have the right weight? Does the argument or discussion develop clearly or logically? Have I forgotten any important points that would support the development? Okay, so these questions are going to guide us and going to help us to know if our draft needs to be improved. So we are human beings, so maybe we are going to have some errors or mistakes in our work. So it's important to read it in a deeply way. So that's why here I'm going to refer to proofreading. So it means checking your work for small errors that may make it more difficult for the reader to understand exactly what you want to say. It means also examining your text carefully to find and correct typographical errors and mistakes in grammar, style, and spelling. Some of the most common types of errors that we have is about punctuation and also spelling. Here we have an example. What is the optimum size for a research team? So as you can observe here, it is clear that a question mark is missing. So that's why here we have a problem about punctuation. In the second one, it is obvious that there is an error about spelling, because here the word previous has been misspelled. We have to be very careful when reading our work before and also before sending it to the teacher. Essays have different purposes. So maybe we are going to write an essay in order to discuss a topic. So that's why we should be aware about the vocabulary that we are going to use when discussing any topic. Okay, so here we can use words or phrases that help me provide a positive aspect, such as benefit, advantage, and phrase as a positive aspect. And also, if we are going to refer to the negative aspects, we can use maybe the words drawback, disadvantage, and the phrase a negative feature. So we can use the following organization in order to write our discussion section, okay? So we can do it by grouping the benefits in one paragraph and the disadvantages in another. Or if we prefer, we can do it by examining the subject from different viewpoints. Discussing ideas involves expressing your points of view and supporting them with valuable evidence. So you can, you must use an appropriate vocabulary that helps you present your ideas in a clear way. So it is important to avoid phrases, personal phrases such as, in my opinion, personally. Yeah, so instead of using them, we can use impersonal phrases such as, it is generally accepted that, it is widely agreed that, most people, it is probable that, the evidence suggests that. So we have to consider this information when writing your essay. Also, we can use ideas that are opposite to our ideas. So that's why here we can, I am going to refer to counter-arguments, which refer to those ideas, okay? So in academic discussion, you must show that you are familiar with both sides of the argument, and it's important to provide reasons to support your position. So it is usual to deal with the arguments first before giving your view. Another purpose that we will have when writing essays can be writing to show a cause and effect. So these authors mentioned that in a cause and effect essay, you discuss the causes for something and effects or results, or maybe we can discuss both causes and effects. So we can use the following organization in order to write our essay. Here I have the block organization. In this organization, you will have to start a short paragraph which often separates one major section from another major section. In the case of chain organization, causes and effects are linked to each other in a chain. One important aspect when writing any type of essay or any type of written work is cohesion, which means joining a text together with reference words and conjunctions so that the whole text is clear and readable. Reference words point backwards or forwards to other words or concepts that have already appeared in the text or are about to appear in the text. Conjunctions are words and phrases that join parts of a sentence together or link a sentence to the next one. Here I have some examples of reference words. We have pronouns, possessive pronouns, objective pronouns, demonstrative pronouns, and other phrases such as the former, the later, the first. Something that we have to keep in mind is that in order to avoid confusing the reader, you have to use these words only when the reference is clear and is not ambiguous. When writing our introductions, maybe we will use vocabulary that is not familiar to the reader. So in this case, it would be necessary to provide definitions about those words. So that's why here I want to focus on definitions. It means to limit or bound, to interpret ideas or words in terms of each other, and to understand one thing by another. So according to Bailey, basic definitions are formed by giving a category and the application. I have an example here of two words, agenda and a grant. And as you can observe here, we have the category of the word and also an example of the application. For example, For an agenda is an agenda is a set of issues to be discussed in a meeting. And a grant is a sum of money given for a specific purpose. When we want to support our ideas, maybe we can make use of examples. So that's why here I'm going to refer to them. And if we use examples, it's important to introduce them by using some phrases. Here we can use, for instance, for example, such as, particularly, especially, and also a case in point, and other phrases too. Generalizations can be used to introduce our topics. They must be supported by clear evidence. So that's why we have to be careful when using them. So here we have an example provided by the author, an example of a generalization. Many plants and animals are threatened by global warming. That, if we said that we need clear evidence, it's important to add an example. So that's why here an example has been added. Many plants and animals are threatened by global warming. Polar bears, for example, are suffering from the lack of art. Another type of essay is problem and solution essays. In a discussing problems and suggesting solution, it is important to state the problem and its causes clearly. Then it's important to present the suggestions and the expected results or consequences. In order to write a successful essay, it's important to consider the three following aspects. An introductory paragraph in which the problem is clearly stated, what has caused it, and the consequences. A main body in which you present suggested solutions, each in separate paragraph together with its consequences and results. And also a conclusion in which you summarize your opinion. The last topic that I am going to refer is style. As you know, when writing academically, it's important to consider an appropriate style to write, okay? So there is not one correct style of academic writing, but in general, it should attempt to be accurate, impersonal, and objective. So there are some important aspects that we have to consider in order to write by using an appropriate style. So it's important not to use idiomatic or colloquial vocabulary. For example, instead of using the words kids or boss, maybe we can use the words children and manager. Also, it's important to use vocabulary accurately. We have to be as precise as possible when dealing with facts or figures. Our conclusion should use tentative language. So maybe we can say unemployment may cause crime, or unemployment tends to cause crime, instead of saying unemployment causes crime. Also, it is important to avoid verbs that show your personal attitude, as adverbs such as luckily, surprisingly. Something that is very important in a formal essay is that you don't have to contract verb forms. So you have to say do not or cannot, but you cannot say don't or can't. You cannot write them. Also, academic English tends to use the passive more than standard English. It shouldn't be overused. We have to avoid the use of etc. and so on when writing lists. And the last one is that we should avoid using two-word verbs. So we have to avoid using go on, bring up. So instead of go on, maybe we can use continue. And instead of mentioning bring up, we can use a raise. Okay. I have finished with this part. Now I would like to refer to all of the activities that you will have to perform in order to pass the course, as you did with the rest of subjects that you already passed. You are going to have a forum, which is mandatory. We will also have five academic chats. Three of them are going to be mandatory and two optional. We are going to have also five video colaboraciones. So three of them are going to be mandatory and two optional. Also, we will work on a wiki. And we will have to work on a distance evaluation and the on-site evaluation. So as you know, at least 70 points are required in order to pass the subject. I am going to refer to the activities that you will have to develop in order to for this part, for the essay section. So the first activity, well, the purpose of all of the activities that I have designed here is that you put into practice all that you have learned. So that's why here I want to focus on summary. So on summarizing. So that's why I ask you to read an article that I have attached to your evaluation. This article is about bullying, and I want you to consider all the steps that have been provided in order to write a good summary. So that's why also I want you to at the end of the summary you write the steps you follow to do it. Okay. So I have designed a rubric for this activity, so it is necessary that before sending the activity you read carefully all of the aspects that have been considered in this part. Okay, so the summary is focused on the main ideas. It is free of grammatical mistakes. It has been written using your own words. The information has been reduced to a suitable length. The steps followed to summarize the article have not been described. And the risk of plagiarism has been another activity that you will have to do is to read a text about brains and sex, that you will find in your textbook on page number 49, and you will have to paraphrase it. Yeah. So as a strategy here, you have that you have to read information in your didactic guide and your textbook. Specifically, read information from units 3 and 6, and also consider the rubric that has been designed to present a high quality work. So here, in order to obtain these 3 points, you will have to write a paraphrase that has a different structure to the original, also that has mainly different vocabulary. It needs to be free of grammatical mistakes. It retains the same meaning, and also the risk of plagiarism has been avoided. For the third activity, I would like you to write a well-organized essay which shows your position about bullying. Yeah. So for this activity, you will have to look for information about bullying in at least 4 different sources, which will help you to support your ideas. So also in your book, you will find information about combining sources. So I want you to apply this theory and to put it into practice. Also a rubric has been designed. It is an 800 word essay which follows the following format: introduction, main body, a conclusion and reference. A cohesion has been considered along the whole essay. Your ideas have been supported by at least 4 different sources. It is free of grammatical mistakes. The information taken from the selected sources is trustworthy. The sources have been carefully combined. The risk of plagiarism has been avoided, and the APA format has been used for site. Okay, so the last activity that you will have to develop is to write a problem and solution essay about the role of English in research and scholarship. You are going to do with the rest of activities, you will have to write this essay. You will have to read information in your textbook and the didactic guide, and also look for information about the topic in at least 4 different sources, which will help you to support your ideas in the same way that you are going to do the activity number three. So the rubric for this is that it is an 800 word essay, which follows the following format. It's the same format that I asked in the previously mentioned activity. Introduction, main body, conclusion, and references. Also here, cohesion has been considered along the whole essay. Your ideas have been supported by at least four different sources. It is free of grammatical mistakes. It has been written by using an academic style. The information taken from the selected sources is trustworthy. The sources have been carefully combined. The risk of plagiarism has been avoided, and the APA format has been used for citing. Okay, so these are the references that I have for the information that I have taken for my presentation. And I don't know if you have any question. Okay, do you have any question? Or maybe if later you don't understand anything, maybe you can write me or maybe you can call me so I can help you. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Will you post the text guide? The syllabus of the course, because I review the email only if there is no information about the guidance and the contents in order to work, because we don't receive the material yet and it needs to work. This is a special thing that I ask you to help us.
Okay, thank you. Okay, don't worry. I'm going to do this this weekend, during this week, okay? I didn't know that you didn't have the material yet.
Yes, we didn't receive the material for any of the two subjects that we are going to study in this second semester.
Okay. But I'm going to do it during this week. Don't worry.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, no more questions? Okay, so thank you very much for your participation.